Welcome back, Troglodytes, to your daily dose of guitar information, the Trogly's Guitar Show. I'm really excited to do this review and demo today. This is of an artist that I had never personally heard of before, and that seemed to be most people's general first reactions when Gibson announced this just yesterday, at the time of recording this anyways. But this is the Jim James ES-335 signature. So before I tell you a little about him and his band, my morning jacket, let's go ahead and get this thing out and just get our first impressions here. Because even if you don't know who the signature artist is, I think you guys are really going to enjoy the unique specs that they threw onto this guitar for not that much of a premium. So first off, you guys know I like my animal-influenced guitars, and this one, not necessarily the guitar that's influenced by it, it's just his own little owl design, but I love that on the case. That's pretty cool, owl flying in, getting ready to grab a mouse or something. I mean, there's no mouse on here, it's just his owl. But this is a USA-level production guitar, but yet they give it a custom shop level case. That's pretty cool. It's got the clasps and one single latch on here, so it's kind of like going after an older Lifton style case. But let's go ahead and open this baby up and take a look. Ooh, I got a nice one. Okay, so this is a ES-335 that just has a few different things that they changed up to make the artist happy with what they're offering. We've got stuff like the boring brown 70s walnut color finish. I like boring brown, but not everybody does. But oh man, mine even gets like a little bit of figuring within it. And of course, we've got some other cool specs to document today yet too. But first, let's go ahead and learn about Jim James. He is the lead vocalist of the band My Morning Jacket, but he's a multi-instrumentalist. He's not only just about guitars like we're documenting today, but he does harmonica, he does keyboard, he just does a whole bunch of different stuff, but he's the front man for his band. And they just recently came out with a new album that is self-titled. That's why this is coming out. He's been on the Jimmy Kimmel Show, the Colbert Show, performing their new songs. And the best way I would describe their music is kind of folk-like, soft rock, almost sometimes pop-ish. It seems very late 60s, 70s vintage inspired as far as the tones go. Like, it kind of reminds me of some Rolling Stones songs, but I'll let you check out a few of their songs to judge for yourself if you're not familiar with the band. I would suggest maybe starting with the song Dance Floors, and I really like the epic intro of One Big Holiday. Like, it has a really cool little meatly intro thing that I think I'll try to demonstrate when we do this playing demo. But now let's go a little bit more in depth in his new signature model. This is a 335 that they limited production worldwide to only 300 of. So that's looking pretty good for future collectability value, that there was very few of these things made. And he's got some interesting specs here that blend 70s and 50s characteristics. So 70s inspired because we have this walnut finish here. That's something you would find on a lot of 335s in the 70s. However, the fretboard did not look like this in the 70s, and they also didn't have this setup, generally. So here's what a 70s 335 looks like. Now granted, there were a few different variations, but generally you would find some sort of a trapeze tailpiece system on it, which would make the guitars feel a little bit different, and a lot of them would actually even have a coil split second toggle switch on the treble side bout of the guitar. And they would also have those small block inlays on the fretboard. So this thing, that would have been really cool if they would have put the coil splitter on there, because then that'd be something that Gibson has not reissued in a long time. I'm not even sure if they've ever done that, but they decided to go like 50s dot ES-335 styles on this one. Then obviously we have a couple of other artist specs on this, just like on our beautiful case here with the owl. You have an owl on the back of the headstock, and that's just beautiful. Again, you guys know I love my animal-influenced guitars, especially when they put them on the backside of the headstock. So other ones you could check out are like the Cobra Burrs, the Black Widow, the Centipede. There were a couple of them out there, so this kind of vaguely belongs within that category now. I guess you could say this guitar is the tree that the owl sleeps in. And in the Gibson announcement for this, I guess the guitar was symbolized as a piece of like driftwood. So, you know, it kind of works. And then you get his Jim James symbol on the truss rod cover. I'm curious if they give us a normal one. But then the other kind of cool 70s spec that they did on this is Clouson waffle back tuners. These are some of the classiest looking tuners that have ever been produced, in my opinion. Now, unfortunately, the vintage ones, they didn't really stand the test of time. They're normally pretty loose and garbage by now, 50 plus years later. But the modern day reissue ones, they're nice and tight. They feel good. They look cool. So Basically, this is just an original collection ES-335 with a few different modifications. So to help you understand that, let's go ahead and make a little graph right here. Original collection ES-335, they are $3,299 brand new. You can get them in 60s cherry, ebony finish, and a vintage sunburst. Those things are unlimited production, and you can see some of the other specs here, like the pickups and whatnot. Now, on the other side of things, for only $200 more, you can get a limited edition guitar that, once again, there's only 300 of these things being made, which makes it look good for future resale value should you decide to move it on. But you get the beautiful custom shop case that I just told you. That's worth the $200 right there. The beautiful walnut finish that is not normally offered. Now, that could be a plus or minus. Not everybody likes walnut. But hey, if you like the walnut finish and you wouldn't be caught dead playing a USA-leveled instrument, there's also custom shop ones. CME does exclusive walnut finishes all the time, so you could check those out on the used market. And then, of course, you get things like the special tuners and the owl on the back of the headstock. In my opinion, despite not knowing anything about Jim James until today, I thought this was a no-brainer. It had so many cool, quirky specs to it. It's well worth that $200 premium. Now again, I'm recording this the day after. I'm very thankful that Musician's Friend just automatically overnighted this to me. They actually rank this as a premium level guitar, so that was kind of surprising despite the fact that, you know, it's not all that expensive. Generally, they reserve that kind of treatment for like custom shop guitars, but this is kind of like a pseudo custom shop, I guess you could say. But anyways, what are my first impressions of this thing straight out of the box? It's a nice gloss finish everywhere. Now, unfortunately, being a 335, there's going to be some light wood splintering that kind of like shakes out of the case. So if it's a little bit dusty, I'm sorry. It's not my fault. We'll fix that in a little bit. The fretboard actually seems to be, you know, not as dry as it can be on some brand new Gibsons. But we'll go ahead and condition that, and then it'll really match that body really well. The neck profile is very 70s inspired, like it's slim but still pretty rounded, but they didn't do that really skinny nut width that some of the 70s 335s have, so that's another kind of 50 spec that I missed. I am noticing that the bottom strap button isn't quite fully secured in the body. I'm not sure if that just wasn't tightened enough or if it needs to be reseated or something. But other than that, it's actually kind of chunky for a 335. I mean, these things still have the maple center block, so they're going to have some weight to them. I suppose we should take a minute to really appreciate this case. I mean, outside of the owl, again, I was telling you it's kind of lift and reissue inspired. It's got that beautiful yellow interior. Like, we normally saw these on, like, the Hendrix SG, and you'd find the same interior on, like, the EDS-1275/double neck. So this really is a super premium case. I mean, the way I see it, as far as pricing goes, they really didn't put anything to the artist's name. They put it all to the specs, so I can appreciate that. But it looks like we get our regular Gibson strap that you get in most Gibson USA purchases after a certain price point. Our regular little baby photo here when it was back in the factory, pre-pack checklist, all that good stuff. And I don't know why, maybe it's because I had this custom shop case, I thought we'd get a COA, but no. That's kind of sad. I wish they would have did like a signature strap. Like, he seems to be kind of slightly hippie vibe, so like a nice flower strap or one of the vintage inspired Gibson ones that they also have. This was such a good deal. I think they could have priced these at least at $4,000 and still easily had sold them. But I guess you could say that is Gibson's early Christmas present to us, a nice deal on this guitar. But I think to learn a little bit more about the Jim James ES-335, let's go ahead and throw it on the workbench to take an individual look at its parts and specs. Inside the Jim Jam James 335. I don't know if he goes by Jim Jam James, but he should if he doesn't. So let's take a look at these special pickups here. Rhythm calibrated T-type in the neck and lead calibrated T-type in the bridge. They just kind of look like a PAF. They say patent applied for on them, which is kind of a throwback to the 70s model. That would have been really cool if they would have reissued the patent number T-tops. And then they actually have the patent number underneath it. That would have been cool, but no, these are more like a PAF style. That could have been a cool attention to detail type thing. But the readings for these guys, 7.5K ohms in the bridge, neck position a little bit less hot at 7.19, and in between, 3.67. So yeah, I mean, they're kind of close to what T-tops are. Those are generally around 7.5. Sometimes they get a little bit underwound like that. So it seems that they are trying to at least go for the DC resistant readings within here.
I would be curious to know what makes this different from Chicago Music Exchange's T-Type pickups. Maybe they just changed the name so Chicago doesn't get upset. But anyways, our neck pickup cavity. Since these are now produced in Gibson, USA, the Memphis plant shut down, we've got Gibson USA style writings in here. Now, normally it's in the bridge pickup, but ES-335, Jim James, 2021, and then this 7W for 70s Walnut. I guess it could also maybe be a weird looking T for translucent walnut, but I have never seen a solid walnut finish come out of Gibson. Then here's what our bridge pickup cavity looks like. So this is constructed the same way as every single 335 is. Well, mostly every 335. Being a translucent color, this is really nice to see the different layers of wood. So the top, back, and sides are crafted with a maple poplar maple sandwich. Basically, they put those together, they form them into the carved top. It's not completely flat. They do the same thing for the back and the sides, and that's how they get the shape here. So the first maple layer is kind of covered over by the finish, but then you see the poplar layer and then another maple before it joins to this. This is the spruce bracing. That's that ugly kind of chewed up, not so nice looking wood right there in the middle. So as the name implies, it braces it against the top, and that's kind of, you know, what gives you your bellied shape. But then what makes a 335 a 335 is the fact that it has a maple center block running straight through it. That kind of helps cut down on your feedback from your F-holes. And that's the wood that you're seeing right here at the bottom of the pickup cavity. That's also what's right under here, but some of the block gets routed away when they do the pickup cavities here. And this right here is your long neck tenon for your mahogany neck right here going into the body. And on the underside of the guitar, you've got the exact same kind of sandwiches going on. So you've got the spruce bracing that you're seeing right here. And then we will break out the endoscope so we can take a look at the kerfing.
But all right, let's go spelunking inside the Jim James 335. Inside here, we've got our sticker that reads Gloss ES-355 JJ. Then we've got our serial number 22041, making it a 2021 made on the 204th day of the year. Initial batch that day, 355th in production. Now that's not 355th of this whole thing, that's just what was stamped that particular day. So now, continuing on from there into the belly of the beast here, we're seeing some of the kerfing that's used on the edge. That kind of braces the top, back, and sides together. And then you can see another little block that they put there. That is at the very top of the horn. This is actually one of the cleaner looking 335s I've seen. As far as like glue seeping out and stuff like that, that is looking really good for modern day production of ES-335s. But now let's look at the center block. That's what's running up and down right here. So that is just complete maple. It goes up and down. We're going more towards the tailpiece now. And that's just a complete block. Now what you're seeing there is some more of that spruce bracing that kind of pairs against that maple block. And again, you see that on the bottom as we were talking about. So you've essentially created two different sound chambers here by blocking it off with that maple. So that means we need to come in through the other F-hole here, where we can see our orange drop capacitors with all of our hand-wired pots here. Uh-oh, something went a little bit crazy there when they were painting the sides of the F-holes black, but I guess does it really matter? But yeah, I would say I'm pretty impressed with the way this looks on the inside here. But just for fun, let's go ahead and check out the other cutaway area. Pretty much the exact same as what we saw on the other side. But now that we understand the construction and have seen that a little bit more, let's just go ahead and take a second to appreciate this top. This is not a VOS finish, so you don't have any of that gunk. It's just a nice glossy finish. Now I did notice some of like the VOS-like treatment on here, but that just polished off. That was just in a certain few areas. It just needed the buffing compound slightly polished out. And you know, all the wood grains on these are going to vary. So, I mean, if you're picky with what you want, you know, ordering from a musician's friend or another dealer that doesn't show you which one you're getting, kind of a risk, but I'm guessing these will probably sell out and then you won't have much of an option after that anyways. Sweetwater's normally your best dealer for choosing your wood grain example, but they're sold out. But underneath our pickguard, you can see it's actually impressing the finish. So what you're seeing right here is where the pickguard is just right up against there. So if you wanted to take the pickguard off, you're going to be left with that mark. And let's see if I can get it to show up. There is like a scratch impression right here because that's where the edge of the pickguard kind of lines up, kind of like right here. But that's just because the body kind of humps up in this area. I mean, they could put spacers on that to prevent that from happening, but you generally end up seeing stuff like that. But thankfully, we don't have any impressions from that thing. But just in case you haven't seen a 335 pickguard in a while, that's what it looks like. Kind of like a big nose.
And then they get this little bracket on the side and it gets screwed into place. And then it's got that little shelf, and that's what helps get you the height you need. That way it's not just riding against the body of the guitar. But now we need to talk about hardware. This features a non-wire ABR1 bridge, which means be very careful. None of these are secured by a wire. They will fall out. Like, I always test these things to see if they'll fall out or not, because sometimes just because they're non-wired doesn't mean they're going to fall out. But these ones, a few of the saddles do fall out. I learned that the hard way. But there you go. It says Gibson ABR1. However, this is a Gibson USA product, so it is not installed the correct way. It has a stud in the body instead of just being one continuous piece being drilled into the top. But one benefit you do get from this version is they actually have it sized out that an Allen key can fit in there, and you can adjust it like that instead of having to use the thumb wheel. So that means you can do a setup under string tension if you wish. And you have a lightweight aluminum tailpiece on this guy, done up by Advanced Plating Incorporated. Moving on to the controls, two independent volumes and two tones. With your three-way toggle switch in your normal location, output jack on the front, nothing too funny with that. We saw all that stuff on the inside. So now, moving on from the maple poplar maple body with the center block, we've got a straight up mahogany neck with a rosewood fretboard, and just as I thought, a little bit of conditioning goes a long way. Much darker color, feels a little bit nicer. I mean, with brand new guitars, you kind of have to wear them in a little bit. They'll feel a bit stiff at first, but once you get your disgusting finger oils all over it, start to play a lot, that's when they really start to feel like well-played in guitars. Now, there are a few QC things I want to mention about this. Like, after conditioning it, I saw some like light scratches in the fretboard, and there's some that are like circular. I mean, these are a little bit above and beyond what I normally see on a Gibson. And this is just kind of nitpicky, but there's a lot of like tooling marks or something on here. My best theory as to what these things are is I think the Plec machine's doing it. Like, it's not getting the proper height set up. So when it's sizing up the fretboard, I think it's, you know, messing up their binding job. But that's nothing new on Gibsons, but here's something you don't always see. Whatever is doing that actually chewed up the fret nibs on this one. You see how it's just like missing right there? It's like it's been tapered off. And it's not just the first fret. It was also done on the second, on the third, and then by the fourth, we finally have that full fret nib. You see the difference that I'm talking about here? Uh-oh, the fifth was like that. That one's almost okay. So it looks like maybe four fret nibs kind of got chopped up. Maybe Gibson can look into what is doing that. It could just be human error, I don't know. But anyways, we've got 22 medium jumbo frets with the white acrylic dots. Standard 12-inch fretboard radius with a 24 3/4-inch scale length. Let's go ahead and capture our neck specs here. So 1.7 inch nut width, that increases to 2.1 by the 12th. That's actually very wide. First fret neck depth, 0.83. That increases to 0.92 by the 12th. They build this neck as a slim taper. Moving on to our headstock, nice and clear with our Gibson Mother of Pearl logo and the crown on the top. But where's our truss rod cover? It's right here, and I've got to say, I am surprised they did not give you a blank one in the case. Now, if you're thinking, oh, it's all right, I'll just scratch that off. It's just a silk screen, right? No, it is not. So it's actually engraved. The way the historic style ones are made is there's a black layer and then there's a white layer. Now the USA's, I think they're actually 3-ply. But what they did is they just carved away the black layer to expose the white layer for the Jim James logo there. So no, it is physically impossible to take that out of it because it is engraved. That's a cool spec. I guess if you really hate it, you could install it upside down. Or just buy yourself a blank one. And now we move on to the backside. There are no control plates on this like a Lucille would have, or a 333. The way they wire these things up are directly through the F-holes and the pickup cavities. It's a bit of a pain, but that's how they do it. Well, actually, I'm not sure. They might actually put all that stuff in before they put the guitar together. But if you ever have to make modifications to one of these guitars, you have to play the fishing game. But as you can see, you have a beautiful back. It is carved, so you've got a little bit of a surface area hump right here, as well as in the middle, kind of like what a Les Paul has on the top. So it's not a completely flat back, and this one actually has, you know, a little bit of wood grain figuring here. Kind of nice. Now, as far as the edges, how do they create these things? It's actually in two different pieces. So down here where the strap button is, you can see where those two pieces come together, and they just kind of glue them there. It always looks like a crack is forming, but that is not the case. Now, unfortunately, our loose strap button is due to over-tightening. So that means you could either put a little plug in here to tighten the hole up. use a bigger screw. I mean, a lot of guys will just swap these out for strap locks, so that wouldn't be an issue at all. Or do the toothpick trick, or just let it be. It's secure, not wobbling. It just never stops tightening, which causes this to spin and not get fully tightened down. It still holds the strap okay. So if you're just playing this at home, yeah, you're probably fine. Just play it as is. However, I mean, if you're gonna gig this thing, you probably want to swap that out. But you will notice these are the larger style strap buttons, kind of like a mix between a strap lock and a regular button. But moving on, we've got our mahogany neck that's stained that beautiful walnut color. And then our little owl here. Now, my only complaint about this owl is it's a decal and it has a transparent layer around it. So if you catch it in the light just right, you can kind of see some dots. But maybe that's like supposed to be snow coming off of our snowy owl or whatever it is. That's just kind of come to be expected when you use a decal type thing like that. But I love the fact that we finally have another animal influenced guitar here with an animal on the back. Now, what's kind of interesting about our serial number is most of the numbers are deep enough that they got completely covered in lacquer, but then you've got the other ones like these fives where they're not completely covered in the lacquer and they've got some white in it because of the buffing compound that they used. But that's the same serial number that we saw on the inside of the tag. At least, I hope it is, otherwise they made a mistake. But you can also see the Gibson USA stamp there too. And here are our beautiful Clouson waffle back tuners. You don't see these things get used enough. They're just cool, so I'm glad to see that they used them on a model. All said and done, this weighs about 8 pounds, 3.1 ounces. Let's go ahead, plug it in, and hear how Jim James 335 sounds. All right, let's go ahead and start with our neck position on one. We'll just start with some simple basic chords. Bridge position, same thing. Middle position. Very nice sounding guitar. And that neck pickup is nice and juicy as it normally is. Noticing this thing stays in tune pretty well for a brand new guitar on new strings. But of course I also oiled up the bridge saddles as well as the nut, so I mean that's kind of to be expected. So far I'd say I'm really liking the tones out of this thing. It's a little bit darker sounding than I'm used to. I'd say I'm happy with that. Let's go ahead and pay tribute to the artist now. Now that we know all about Jim James's new signature ES-335, what are my final thoughts on this thing? I had a lot of fun with it. It's got a nice kind of dark classic rock tone. Maybe it's just because I was listening to some of his music and trying to play one of his songs, but I had a great time with this. So if anything, I found a new artist that has some interesting music to check out. I really like that Big Holiday song. That's just such an epic intro that he's got going on there. So I thought that'd make a great little tone demonstration piece. I hope you enjoyed that. Now, as far as Gibson's QC, yeah, I mean, there's things that could have been done better on this guitar. I think the biggest offense is really this spinny bottom button. It really shouldn't have left the factory like that. All the other small little tooling marks, yeah, we can gripe about them, but at the end of the day, they do not affect playability. Pretty much the only negative thing I can say about this that I've further discovered is the strings rattle the saddles here. That's a nice little alliteration of a rhyme, but as you're strumming, sometimes the ABR1 bridge saddles will buzz, and that's kind of a mild annoyance, but it's all there. The neck is very thin on this guitar, so make sure you like thin necks as well. That might be a slightly different spec compared to the original ones. So would I suggest buying one of these? I think it depends when you're watching this video. Brand new, absolute steal. If you were already in the market for a brand new ES-335, you might as well spend $200 more to get the limited edition one that has the owl on the back, if you like this color, because I can see these things growing in value over time. I'm hoping that they don't just inflate instantly like some things have been doing lately. I view this as more of, you know, in 5 or 10 years, these things might be worth, you know, maybe $5,000 or something like that, because they're a cool limited edition 335. And there are a good amount of those things out there, but this thing has some interesting specs while still maintaining everything that a 335 is well known for. I mean, these pickups are quite fascinating. So, Troglodytes, I hope you enjoyed checking this guitar out. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, and we will catch you tomorrow on the next episode. Take care. As always, if you're interested in being the next owner of one of these demo guitars, you can check them out on my website, troglysguitarshow.com. There's some links in the description.